Thank you, sir. I'd like to now take the pleasure of inviting Padma Bhushan, Dr. V.K. Saraswat, SA to RM and Secretary Defence, R&D, to please address the gathering.
Very good morning, Honorable Raksha Mantri Ji, Air Chief Marshal Brown, PVSM, AVSM, VM, ADC, Shri R.K. Mathur, Secretary Defence Production, Shri Alangmovan, Mr. Tamilmani. I see some very distinguished guests here, Dr. Arunachalam, Dr. Atre, and many distinguished participants from abroad, from India, invitees, members and fellows of Aeronautical Society of India, dear students, media members, ladies and gentlemen, it's a matter of great pleasure and privilege to address such a galaxy of participants who have come to attend this seminar. At the onset, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to Honorable Raksha Mantri for making it possible to come and preside over this function and inaugurate this seminar. This seminar is most timely, particularly when we are talking about aerospace products, challenges in design and deployment. And when we come to deployment, I make sure that we have the blessings of our Chief of Air Staff today among us. We are really grateful to him also for making it possible. And since the journey from design to deployment is going through the production, we have the Secretary of Defense Production to be the bridge in this whole game. So we are thankful to all of you for making this seminar a great success. India has matured today in the field of aeronautics and avionics. We have completed almost 6 decades of work in this country. The canvas has expanded, which is visible when I express to you what all we have done in the last 60 years and where we are heading to. The mode of development and production has been indigenous and collaborative. That's why you have today participation of large number of international collaborators, partners in this seminar, and also in various projects and programs which are underway. I will start talking about you about the expanded canvas of Indian aeronautics, starting from our most important item, that is light combat aircraft Tejas, which has just completed 2,000 flights, and that was yesterday announced with IOC 1 completed and LCA Navy also completed its flight trial, and we have the LSP 7, the aircraft which is already flying now, completing all the trials at Jaisalmer, Uttarlai and many other places like Jamnagar. Number of test points have been done and we are heading for final operation clearance, including the release of R-73 missile. So that is the kind of integration activity which has been completed and it is heading in the right direction. We have our own program on Hindustan Jet Trainer, HJT-36, which has completed 619 sorties at 750 kilometers per hour, flying at 0.75 Mach. And 3 successful streaming in flight were conducted this year. Our Jaguar is being upgraded with a Darien 3. This is another program where you have the complete state-of-the-art avionics systems like radar, altimeter, EW systems, communication systems are being integrated. So that is where you are heading. In November, we conducted this exercise. Mirage being fitted with the SPICE 2000, again an example of international collaboration, which is a precision-guided submunition for the Indian Air Force, and it will start supplying for the future integration. Our BrahMos program has moved substantially, having completed its duty for Indian Army and Indian Navy. Now we are heading for its integration with Sukhoi Mark 1, design expertise, and now we are heading into the real integration activity. So this is another major breakthrough. For the first time, we'll be integrating an indigenous missile with the aircraft. Astra air-to-air missile, which is being designed and developed for multiple platforms, has completed its three major flights recently, indicating that the integration of the seeker has successfully been done and the missile has overcome all the design problems. I am sure next year we will be integrating this with Sukhoi. In the area of avionics, which is a major area, DCMOS, the integration of Sukhoi 30, is in progress, and that will ensure that all the problems which you are facing with respect to aerodynamics, placement of the sensors and others have been completed. So there is a progress taking place in that direction also. There was a requirement to develop the indigenous tires for Sukhoi Mark 1, and I think this, with the help of industry MRF, we are in a position to make good progress, and clearance was going to be accorded. We are also developing now air-launched long-range standoff precision-guided air-to-ground weapon systems for the Indian Air Force, that is called the Smart Anti-Airfield Weapon System, SAW. So that will be a design and development program which will come very quickly. Our own AWNC program has today made tremendous progress. Today, what you will be seeing in the Aero India, that two of the aircrafts are available, and the integration of the radar and the complete ground segment has been completed, which is a major breakthrough in the AWNC program. Certification flight testing of light combat helicopter done by HAL, LCH, has been carried out. Two prototypes are flying at present. Similarly, light utility helicopter design and development is in progress that will certainly meet the requirements of Indian Army and Air Force. We are also heading towards the development of rocket 57mm. First trial was conducted in 2007, which will be on the Mi-8 helicopters. And ALH completely has been fitted with the WSI. The weapon system integration has been completed. That is yet another milestone as far as the canvas is concerned. Radar warning receivers, D-29 EW systems, all are in the advanced stage of integration. And LCA is being fitted with the Unified Electronic Warfare System. Major program in the UAV area is the Rustam 2, which is now in advanced stage of design, and I'm quite certain that by the end of this year or early next year, we'll have the first flight trial of Rustam 2 going on. We are now working on major indigenous programs, and particularly integration of the Helina, that is the helicopter launch NAAG system, onto the ALH, that will be the Indian anti-tank system being integrated on that. But there are many programs which are just being worked out, and these programs include anti-radiation missile for the Air Force and major programs in the future development of the aircraft like AMCA, Advanced Medium Combat Aircraft, at the design stage, the fifth generation fighter aircraft which is being developed in collaboration with Russia, and MMRCA which is going to be produced in this country. In addition to that, you have just the clearance which has been awarded for the Indian AVAC, the Indian AVAC system. So you can see now large number of projects and programs are going to be taken up in future that would require tremendous amount of technology growth as far as the requirement of this country is concerned. Now, where does this take us? Where does the technology go for meeting the challenges which are coming in all the programs which I have identified? If you look at AMCA, which is going to be our fifth plus generation aircraft, we have to graduate from today's systems to many technologies which will be the hallmark of that particular aircraft, including the super cruise, the serpentine air intakes, stealth technologies with all the new materials like nanomaterials, aerodynamics for stealth, structures for stealth, and IR suppression as far as the stealth is required from the engine. And obviously, this will require, as I mentioned yesterday also, the new methods of design. The model-based design would be required. New design tools will be integrated for doing this activity. And to ensure that we are first time right and we have no hitches during development, we would need high-fidelity simulation with virtual reality integrated along with that. As such, we have gone into LCA on the glass cockpit, but integrated avionics and integrated health monitoring system will also be part of the AMCA program. Integration of the flight control and the engine control will also be required. And we would like to graduate, as far as the electrical integration is concerned, from today's large copper cables and fiber optic cables to complete photonics interconnect to reduce the weight and volume of the, and also the susceptibility to the EMIMC in that particular area. Conformal antenna, G-glass cockpit, general systems is another area which we faced a lot of problems while developing LCA. We find that while we are concentrating more on the aerodynamic structures, controls, avionics, we have not been able to give enough attention to the development of the general aircraft systems, which starts from the suspension like the landing gears, fuel management systems, brake management systems, and many of the other auxiliaries like the auxiliary power systems and so on. I think there's a need for this gathering to start giving a lot of attention in that particular area. Obviously, when we are going to build a fourth generation or a fifth generation aircraft, we have to also look at what are the technologies for manufacturing which are going to be required. And those manufacturing technologies have to be either established ab initio or the present ones have to be upgraded. I had mentioned yesterday that we need to have a very strong base for manufacturing the composite structures, but for both primary and secondary structures using the latest technologies. We need to have what is called net shape forgings and the facilities for that, and also to make sure that we have engine manufacturing capabilities, the latest in terms of single crystal blade technology, directionally solidified blades, BLISK. All of them will have to form part of our manufacturing process. It would require, both in private and public sector, upgradation of the infrastructure available and integration of the various new technologies which are emerging. When we have to do all this, obviously it is not going to be done by the few people who are presently engaged in the ongoing programs. It would require a large number of human resources, a large number of human resource which is skilled in the aeronautics and aerospace development. Our estimates go that if we have to handle all the programs which are there in HAL, DRDO, NAL, and if we also go the regional transport aircraft, if we cover all of them, we would need about 400 to 500 aeronautics and good engineers who are skilled for the next 5 to 10 years. That kind of human resource we have to generate. And this human resource generation is not an easy task, because the number of educational institutions which are today giving this kind of directed education for the design and development of aircraft and aerospace systems are limited. So we will have to take some action. And also the quality of the engineers which are coming today to participate in these programs also needs to be upgraded. Well, how do we go for that? The main thing what we can do there is we have to use the IT in a big way. In fact, today when we look at the internet, we see that all countries have switched over for the design and development activities for the aerospace to an IT network process. Both all the tools and design tools are getting shared. The data banks are being shared using the virtual networks, and all the simulation facilities are being shared using the IT techniques. I think we will have to also do the same thing. Second thing which we have noticed in DRDO, when the engineers are coming today, they are highly glued to the simulation and design activities using the present computer tools. But the aerospace or aeronautics, world over it has been found, does not go purely by what you see on the computer. We have to go back to our old system of design and development, where we used to do design, develop, build, test, evaluate, and come back. And that is the cycle which has to be actually taught to all the engineers when they are coming out from institutions. We have limited design capabilities in our education institution, in our laboratories. We have design centers in NAL, we have design centers in ADE, ADA, HAL, and a few other places, but that's not adequate. What we need to build is that educational institutions will have to rig up multiple design and simulation teams if we have to meet all the challenges which are emerging. Whether it is the UAV, or it is the missile, or it is the aircraft, or any of the associated auxiliaries which are required, they need to be directly, the students have to be directly exposed to each one of them in that form. Merely a theoretical grinding of that is not going to help. What we need is a directed education for aeronautics, What we were yesterday discussing with the Royal Aeronautics Society people, that when we have a chartered engineer, the chartered engineer actually is a guy who is capable of doing design, development and production. He is not just an aerodynamics or a structure or an avionics person. He is having the overall capability for carrying out the development of aeronautics. I think we will have to direct our education system in that form. As far as the infrastructure is concerned, I think DRDO is taking all the steps now to upgrade our wind tunnel facilities, our design and development facilities, our supercomputer facilities. But still we are dependent on all our design tools, particularly coming from the foreign countries. We need to have our CFD tools being generated, so you have the CFD codes which are indigenous, which are part of the entire community which is working in various academic institutions and within DRDO and NAL and other places to have their own codes so that we have something unique which will suit our requirement. I would like to take this opportunity to thank everybody who have come to attend this seminar, and I wish that the proceedings of this seminar, the discussions during the next one day, will enrich all of us and give a major boost to India's aeronautics and aerospace development programs, and we will come out as winners. Please join us. Thank you very much.